Good Shabbos. You know, they say that on Shavuot, the holiday that celebrates our receiving of Torah, and you remember, of course, that Torah is the very precious book that asks us how we could bring truth to the world. Torah is soul-opening words that teach us to choose righteousness. It's the keys that unlock the hidden mysteries of creation. Torah is all those things and more. They say that on Shavuot, the night when we receive all these treasures of Torah, in the middle of the night of Shavuot, at midnight, in fact, the skies part, the light of heaven shines, words of Torah are revealed, and even prayers are answered. Which is why, when Rabbi Jessica and I were on a call with other rabbis and leaders in the Jewish Emergent Network, some of the communities we connect with from across the country, like Romamu in New York, 6th and I in DC, and there's many others. And we're on this call regarding the Shavuot all-night learning festival we're hosting together. It's traditional to study all night. We got concerned. Because if we're celebrating all together from at least four different time zones, when is midnight? Well, I learned via Nechama Leibowitz, via Rabbi Samuel Hirsch, via the Talmud, that we needn't worry too much about the midnight thing. Because, in fact, he teaches that the Talmud says that Torah was not given on Shavuot at all. It was given on the next day. No, really, it says that. In other words, the holiday of Shavuot does not celebrate our receiving Torah, the key to all the secrets of the world. But instead, it celebrates the culmination of our preparations to receive Torah. Because remember, after we left Egypt, it's not like we got handed Torah as we went through customs on the way out. It's not like we got Torah in the sea. We didn't even get Torah for our first Shabbat. We had to wander for 7 weeks, getting ready to get ready. And if you're considering what that amount of time would feel like, well, let's just say we've been sheltering in place here for about 7 weeks, give or take. Or if you want to have that sense of time, you can consider Marilyn, our ritual maven, who counts each day from Pesach to Shavuot, 7 days of counting, the Omer. It's our tradition. Either way you imagine it, it's a lot of counting. It's a lot of preparing. Wouldn't it make the most sense to culminate all that preparation with our receiving the actual Torah? What are we supposed to learn from this? I learned this week from the Sfat Emet, and he's commenting on the time of priests and sacrifices. He says that there's something in the Torah called the Esh Tamid, and it's the fire that must always burn on the altar. And Torah describes it, Esh Tamid. And even though God commands us saying this fire is not allowed to go out, Sfat Emet says, there's also a fire in each one of our souls. And this fire too, says God, this one may also not go out. So long as we live, it's a command that we have to tend this fire. And the Sfat Emet says, not only is it a command, it's a promise from God. No matter what, no matter how long we have to wait, no matter how much darkness and loss there is around us, and sometimes even within us, no matter how faint the fire gets, even if we try to extinguish it, the fire within each of us does not go out, for it cannot go out. So perhaps the reason we celebrate the culmination of the preparation is because we realize that without feeling the presence of the fire within ourselves and knowing it is in each of us, without our knowing that this fire burns even in times of great waiting and darkness, we might not feel we deserve the Torah. We might be afraid to try to receive it. Even if the Torah were to be put in our very hands, the letters would stay flat on the page. Even if we were invited to stand right at Sinai, the gates of Torah would be locked. 1,000 Shavuot midnights could come and go, and we'd still be afraid to pray for anything. 600,000 letters of Torah could fall around us like snow, and we wouldn't be able to catch a single one. If we didn't know we had the fire, wouldn't matter what's in front of us, we wouldn't receive a thing. There's a story about Akiva, one of our greatest all-time scholars, who it says in Avota Rebbe Natan, up until the age of 40, he'd not studied a thing. Now, 40 was not the very sprightly young baby age that it is today. One day, Akiva standing by a well in Lida that had a stone, and the stone had a deep indentation in it. And he asked, "Who hollowed out the stone?" And the people there said, "Akiva, don't you know that stone was hollowed out from some water from the well, falling on it day after day?" Akiva thought to himself, "Is my mind harder than this stone?" And the text said that Akiva goes to school the next day with his child, and he and his child begin learning letters together, Aleph, Bet, and eventually he becomes the scholar Akiva. Now, I love the story, not only because the great Akiva makes the unusual connection between his massive brain and a rock, not only because of how long it takes Akiva to notice. You'll notice he takes a lot longer to be ready than even our 49 days of preparation. I love how long it takes him to notice, but also I love what he notices. Akiva, one of the greatest minds of his generation, is a very late bloomer. We don't know who he was for the first 40 years. It's possible that he was relatively unengaged with the world. And it's also possible he thought about learning many times, that there was the beginning of wanting to learn somewhere deep, deep in him, an Esh Tamid, a fire he couldn't always see. And so the metaphor of the rock being slowly eroded by a drop of water, something the eye cannot see in real time, this was not only something Akiva thought could happen or would happen in the future. In that moment, whether he knew it consciously or not, Akiva was also talking about something that had already happened. Let me explain. He had gone from someone who had never studied and would never study to a person that was willing to look within and see possibility. He was willing to see the possibility that was within him, even him. The holy fire of possibility that had already been burning his whole life. And I want to suggest the Shabbat that for Akiva, just as it is for us, there are also things in us, solid as rocks, that just like for Akiva, they had to be altered and shifted before he would even know what it was he so yearned to do. So it is with us. There are things within us that need to alter and shift before we can even acknowledge the Esh Tamid, the fire that is always within us. In other words, Akiva noticed the rock because he was already like that eroded rock. After his 40 years, he was ready to say something out loud, to try to go to the schoolhouse and learn one letter. Sometimes our preparations are elegant. Sometimes we prepare and we get ourselves ready and we count the Omer like Tzadikim. And sometimes we forget. Sometimes our circumstances are so fruitful, we see who we need to be and we run toward possibility. And sometimes we live in moments where we are under such great duress and we are suffering loss. We can't imagine wanting to receive anything except relief. But whether we know it or not, tradition teaches we are preparing just the same. The fire burns in us, Esh Tamid, just the same. It's just sometimes we know it, and sometimes it's harder for us to see. I'll close with a teaching from Rab Yaakov Moshe Sharlip, who's the chavruta of Rab Abraham Isaac Cook. And he teaches that there's two kinds of miracles. There's the kind everyone can see, supernatural miracles, the famous ones like plagues or sea splitting or the Torah being revealed at Sinai. But actually, he says those miracles, they're the lower level of miracle. First of all, as we know, they don't last. They come and they go. And the whole point is just to inspire people who see them and make them feel a certain way and arouse a feeling that there's something holy in the world. But then that miracle is gone. So the higher level miracle, he says, is the one that is so small as to be unnoticed. It's incremental, not unlike a drop of water on a rock. It's virtually undetectable, not at all supernatural, an internal movement within a soul that goes unnoticed for a long time, but creates an unmistakable, permanent shift. This, says Rabbi Charlotte, that's a true miracle. It's growth and it's miraculous because it changes everything. And in fact, just like Akiva had to gestate his yearning internally for 40 years in order to have the courage to say something out loud that would allow him to learn the one letter that would inspire countless others, so too the internal barely perceptible shifts within us, whether we fully know it or not, whether we're preparing to receive Torah or not, those shifts are the true miracles. Those are the shifts that perhaps over many years will allow us to eventually open up our arms like Akiva, to catch one of the 600,000 letters of Torah, the letter of Torah that is destined just for us, that has been written just for us, and waits to be illuminated by the very fire that is only within us. And of course, it will happen precisely and exactly and only at midnight, whenever you think midnight happens to be.